On the phone with us, we're going to have Dickie Dennis. He is the guy that climbed the fence at Richmond in 2014 and was obviously kicked out of the race. So why don't you tell us your story about what happened with you in Richmond in 2014, right?
Well, what went down was there's like four guys that when you see one of us, you see all of us, just like the Chill Boys, you know?
Hell yeah.
Here in my hometown, and we were going to make it like a bachelor's party. One of my buddies was getting married that weekend, and one of the guys went out and purchased tickets for all of us. And we went up there and had a pretty good time tailgating and stuff. Wasn't really getting drunk, because I really like to enjoy enough of the race so that I can remember it, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Had a few beers, but I wasn't too tore up, and partaking in other things and stuff. But got into the race, and they're always there, you know, Dale Jr. fans.
Oh, yeah.
And I don't put down on Dale Jr. He's a great driver. He's a really great driver. I personally think he is a hell of an announcer.
Right, yeah, I do too. I agree.
A commentator, however you want to say that. But this Dale Jr. fan was sitting directly behind me, and he was poking at me and ragging on me about my Kevin Harvick shirt that I had just got down there at the souvenir stand. And he messed around and spilled the beer all over the back of my shirt.
Oh.
And there was getting ready to be a rumble. I turned around and looked at him. I said, the safest place for him was if I was sitting on that damn catch fence. And he said I didn't have the kindness, so I had to hold my beer moment. And that's how it went down. I went cruising down the bleachers pretty much at a run, because there was a few openings in the seats. You know, you can step on the seats instead of the steps, right?
Yeah.
I was hauling down out of there, and I got right down to the bottom of the grandstands, and I noticed the two security had just finished their little patrol they do, looking at each other, and they had done an about face and was headed away from each other. And I seen the window, and the cables that are up on from running from one pole to the other is actually what assists me. They were they're super tight. They're like 3/4 inch galvanized cable, maybe 3 foot apart, and it's like ladder rungs. So, you know, what I did was pretty simple. Sort of a retired iron worker. I did quite a bit of steel climbing in my life. I've repelled out of helicopters for Uncle Sam in my army gig that I did. No fear of heights. God. The only thing I fear is that the Lord's not going to let me in heaven, boss. That's all I fear, and I'm working on making sure I'm respectable, and he'll do that.
I didn't realize you were in the military.
Yeah, I did 20 years for our country. I was in the Army. I started out, my first permanent duty was with the 101st in Fort Campbell, Kentucky. And I transferred from there to Fort Riley, Kansas, and went to a retraining brigade there. After that, I got stationed in Fort Ord, California, where I was like in a ready-react unit. We got deployed a lot. We traveled a whole lot. I got to put my hands on the pyramids and the Sphinx over in Egypt. Got a little bit of training done in Alaska at the Northern Warfare Center. Did the Jungle Operations Training Center in Panama.
Wow.
I wouldn't take none of it back. I got a little few things I deal with a therapist through the VA occasionally, but, you know, I'm good.
Tracy says, what was his MOS?
11B10, and I had a secondary MOS of 63 Tango. They don't call it that now. They've changed all the acronyms. I was a Bradley mechanic. I had my own recovery vehicle. I would go out and pick up broken down Bradleys, hook to them like a wrecker, and pull them out of harm's way and stuff.
That's pretty cool.
My primary MOS was 11B. That's infantry. I was a bush beater, bullet blocker, ground pounder, whatever you want to call it. You know, yeah. They teach us how to kill people in so many stupid different ways. Most of the time when you walk up on a tool in the garage and you're thinking about how you're going to work on an engine with it, I'm thinking about how deadly it could be upside somebody's head. And, that's what they're working on with me at the VA to try to make that go away.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
Not to see everything as a weapon.
I got you. She said, Tracy said her son was an EOD.
Yeah, right? That's fun.
Yeah.
That's explosives.
Yeah. Yeah. And then
that was one of my my downfall's in the military. I love to mess with the pyros too much.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, simulators, hand grenades, flares. They got these parachute flares that are really cool that I would like to have when I go kayaking at night.
A parachute flare.
You just shoot the flare up and a parachute pops out. You know, it's about the size of a Gatorade bottle. You take the top off and put it on the bottom and slap it. It's a primer.
Oh.
And it's like a warming candle, sort of, right?
Okay.
And when it gets up, maybe about 200-300 feet in the air, it illuminates, and at the same time, a little small parachute keeps it drifting so you can see what's illuminated out in front of you if enemies approaching. And yeah, they're really cool.
Oh, wow. Very cool. So, man, that's interesting. Rachel said, thank you for your service. Awesome. Thank you for protecting America. River, thank you for your courage and service.
When people tell me that, you know what I tell them back? I say thank you for caring. Caring enough to acknowledge that I, at one time, signed my life away to protect the idiots you see on the TV now.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry, it's a touchy subject.
I understand.
They came over there, and I got up on the fence. If you've seen the video, when I throw my arms out and I'm looking like Jesus,
yeah.
That's when I realized I had left my phone up in the bleachers. I wanted to get a selfie when Keselowski and Harvick were coming out of turn three into turn four. You would not believe the amount of wind on top of that fence from the race cars. It is wild up there.
I bet.
Anyways, I sit up there, they brought out the caution, and I figured, okay, damage done, get down now, the cops are down there. This one female cop, she's giving me the finger to come down, and so I come on down. Five of them grabbed me and made me motionless until they got the cuffs on me. Took me back up under the bleachers to a little primary holding cell they got back there. This police officer gave me a bottle of water while I was cuffed. Set it on her golf cart. She testified in court I tried to drown myself with that bottle of water in.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, I'm handcuffed. So she set it on the golf cart. I got the lid off of it, you know, with my mouth and everything. And I picked it up with my mouth and turned my head back, drinking the water. And she come out of the little office there and grabbed it. And when she grabbed it, she squeezed the bottle.
Oh, I'm sure, yeah.
Gosh. You know, and I got to choking up. And she testified in court I tried to drown myself with a bottle of water.
Yeah, that's crazy.
That's the real deal. That's what happened.
Yeah.
I ended up with 45 days consecutive locked up in, I was in like solitude because I had anxiety medications I was taking and they didn't want me in general population, and like $7,000 worth of court costs and fines and stuff. But it's all behind me now. It's 5 years. I'm looking at 5 years if I ever put foot on that property again. But I've already gone 5 years of races without that place. I would think maybe all the NASCAR fans that thought it was so cool would get together and get a petition to see if, you know, some Dickie Dennis could get back into the Richmond race. But
yeah.
Right down the road, I got Martinsville. I got Bristol right over here, you know.
There you go.
I don't have to go to Richmond. I got an NHRA drag racing track 15 minutes from my house.
All right, so is there like a statute of limitations? Like, let's say you got 10 years behind you and then you can go back? Or do they just say never again?
No, it's banned for life.
Okay. I thought I'd remember
for
you
life,
saying that.
But what I heard, though, is that now Richmond's under new ownership or something because of some NASCAR sanctioning that went down or whatever. Something. I might not be saying it right. Somebody bought out some stuff, and Richmond was one of those tracks. And I was thinking now it's under new ownership. But see, that's not even going to matter. It's the county of Henrico.
Oh, okay.
That court ordered me to stay off of their property, and that includes the amphitheater for all the concerts, the convention center that's up there that does the boat shows, the gun shows. I can't do none of that on their property no more.
Oh, my gosh. All right. Well, thanks so much for calling, man.
And, get back with me, and we'll discuss that kayaking thing in the near future. I'm going this Wednesday to check on a few things, but you hit me up, and we'll get it laid out and planned out.
All right. Sounds good, buddy. Talk to you later.
Have a good evening, all y'all.
All right, you too, man. Thanks, Seba. All right, very cool. That was our buddy, I'll just say River Rat for now, because I think he just has his alias on here. But he does tune into WAME radio pretty much every day, especially in the evenings. That was good. That was entertaining because he's been through some experiences there, and I always wanted to hear the rest of the story, and there you got it.